Welcome in to another episode of the DNVR Avalanche Trade Deadline Frenzy. We're going up north to Canada for this one. Didn't think we were going to do much for Canada, but a little bit of the restrictions lifted when it comes to picking up players, AJ.
Well, and it also helps that it looks like Calgary is falling apart.
Doesn't hurt when you want to pick up players, pick some bones. Yeah.
Watching their brand new head coach call out their star player for his effort.
Trying to reward him for his 500th game.
Instead of pumping his tires for 500 games played, it was, let's talk trash about his 499th.
Not the best look. Not the best.
Things are going super well.
Meanwhile, Edmonton is still destroying everything up there offensively, at least.
Yeah, well, that division, its three best teams at this point are just offensive nightmares in various forms.
Very true.
So, good for them.
Yeah, interesting enough, most of what we're looking at here isn't super offensive impact coming out of Calgary as far as trade targets.
Yeah.
Should we start with your bae? The man, the mustache, the legend, Sam Bennett.
He's my boo. Sure.
Hey, you're the one who tried to sell him months ago on the podcast, so.
Did I, or did we just have an honest conversation?
I feel like we had an honest conversation, but I gotta tell you, watching this dude's highlights for this video, trying to get myself in the mindset and get clips, obviously, I hate watching this dude play, and it's nothing against the guy, but he plays ugly hockey. It is not pretty to watch.
Yeah, the people who pine for hockey of yesteryear, whichever year they have decided is the glory year for them, they love Sam Bennett. Like, he plays.
It's dead puck era.
It's very grindy. It's very physical. There's not a lot of creativity. It's very straight lines, and you would think that he would be more coach's dreams, and it just hasn't worked out that way for him. He's unhappy in Calgary. He's never developed the kind of offensive upside, the offensive production, the ability to finish often enough out of a guy that they were hopeful would be a huge piece for them as a top five pick. And now that, you know, I think leaving Calgary, especially at his age, you're not having that conversation anymore. You're not like, oh, well, if maybe he goes somewhere else and he rediscovers what made him special as a prospect. Like, come on, it's not going
to
happen.
You're expecting him to be what he is at this point.
You're comfortable. You make the move for that guy because you're comfortable with what you're getting. And maybe you get an uptick. Maybe he goes from 28 points to 35 points, you know, something like that. But you're not looking at him as like a, well, now he'll be a middle six guy who can give you 40 points.
Right. Anything's possible. It could happen, but that's not why you trade for him.
Yeah. You're not trading for him with that in mind. If it happens, great, but it's not a thing that you're banking
on. Can you sell me on how this isn't just Tyson Jost, but 3 inches taller and 30 pounds heavier?
Well, with the way that Tyson Jost has developed this season.
Sure. The defense won't be not going
to
be.
Tough to make the argument here.
Pre-2021 Tyson Jost.
Yeah, well, when with Bennett, you know, he gets a lot of credit for playing center, and he doesn't really. He's more of a left wing.
Yeah.
But the thing is that he plays the heavy game, you know, whereas Tyson Jost, we watch him and we appreciate the smarts and the little details, right? You know, he's very good with a disruptive defensive stick, and
the work ethic is certainly there.
There's a lot of little stuff about Tyson Jost that we appreciate. But with Sam Bennett, if you're a person who really likes a more physical brand of hockey, he's easier to appreciate. Yep. He hits guys. He plays with a physical mentality. It's very aggressive. He gets on. He's hard on pucks. He's very effective in physical confrontation. It's his comfort zone.
So is this less a comparison to Tyson Jost and more of a comparison/replacement to Matt Calvert, stylistically at least?
Yeah, I mean, I think the hope is more you get a Nichushkin, you know, a heavier play style.
Is Nichushkin's play style really that heavy at times?
I think so. I think Nichushkin gets, like, he's not going out. Sam Bennett is more physical than pretty much anybody on Colorado's roster.
I'd say pretty cleanly as the forward core.
So there's not, like, a great comparison to him. To what he does, but as a left wing, he would fit in different roles wherever they would want him. We've talked about this in depth before, so
go check out our podcast if you haven't. There's a whole episode on Sam Bennett if you search for it.
Yeah, it's okay. We're not in love here, but it's okay.
I feel like that's the story of a lot of the Avs trade deadline is. You're getting better, but how much better, really?
Yeah, well, and guarding against failure is as much of the goal here as it is to notably improve. You're giving yourself one more guardrail against injury is a lot of what this deadline, I think, is going to be about for Colorado.
So we talked about the big guy, if you like that physical brand of hockey. Let's talk about the polar opposite of that in Andrew Mangiapane.
Significantly better player in the NHL.
Pretty cleanly.
But smaller, phenomenal underlying numbers, and having an offensive breakout this year in a larger role where we're no longer looking at him as a fourth-line guy that could do a little bit of damage every once in a while. He's firmly put himself into the conversation as a potential middle six regular.
Yep.
And signed through next year at right around $2.5 million.
An RFA as well. Yeah.
Yeah. He is a guy who is right in the heart of his prime. Calgary has no really good reason to move him. The big thing is that this hasn't worked with the Flames.
Yeah.
And
there's a ticking time bomb in Calgary at this point.
If they start to sell guys off, having Andrew Mangiapane waste his prime in Calgary as a really good middle six player makes no sense.
Yep.
They need star talent. And if they could, if Colorado, even if they wanted to overpay, you throw a first-round pick Calgary's way, and you know you're comfortable with the idea that it is 25 or lower. You throw a first-round pick Calgary's way for Mangiapane, you've overpaid for him. But this is their Blake Coleman move. This is a guy that fits their identity, fits the style that they want to play, fits all of the things that you could say that they would need, gives them another play-driving force while having the offensive pop where you could move Nichushkin down to your fourth line and have a third line of Mangiapane, Jost, and Donskoy.
And that's dangerous right there.
Even and if you really, really wanted to give it a whirl, you could try Nichushkin, Mangiapane, and Donskoy. I would say that that's probably not why you go out and get him.
Yeah.
But you could try it, is the thing. Once he's on the roster, now you get to utilize him however you want. I think like we like where Tyson Jost's game has gone this year, but I still think we're looking at more of a 4C than a 3C, and the production around him is starting to separate, even as he is on that line. And Mangiapane would just slide right in to the Nichushkin role. They wouldn't lose much of anything with the defensive side of it.
Yep.
They would gain a lot on the offensive side.
He's another guy, if you're min-maxing your power play, you can drop into PP2 as well. It's, you know, always going to be a little bit in flux there if you're running Donskoy, whatever. But the versatility that a player like this can bring to a lineup is where the Avs can really make gains, I think. How realistic is that for them? We'll see. If they're giving up a first-round pick, that means they're not going to have a first or a second. I'm not saying I hate the
year
idea.
This is the year to do it, though.
Yeah,
this is the year to overpay, and especially because Mangiapane would be an easy protect. He's on a very cost-efficient contract, so that does not hurt them going into next year. And it would open up one more guy for Seattle to take in expansion that has a higher salary.
And as we've talked about before, any player at the forward level that's middle six caliber that the Avs go get, it's a very simple offseason decision of Saad is gone.
Yeah.
So.
And you lose Saad, but if you put Alex Newhook in that spot.
Right. That's the other factor.
And then you have Mangiapane there next year still, you're in a very fine spot. If you decide to play Alex Newhook as, say, your third line center, Mangiapane could probably play up.
You get away with it for a while, yeah.
On that left wing next to Kadri and Burakovsky. It would probably be a touch too much for him, but it would at least be an experiment worth trying. So
that's a get-you-by until Newhook is comfortable type of thing. Yeah.
Definitely. This is I said it earlier, this is your Blake Coleman move. This is the big thing that they could do that would fit everything they do.
On the forward side, this is the all-in for the cup. And it has the bonus of continuing to be a factor in their roster going forward.
Yeah, the big difference with Blake Coleman is that Blake Coleman is a UFA this year at the end of the season. At the end of next year, he'll still be an RFA.
Yep.
So Colorado will still be able to turn. They will have an opportunity to turn it into a long-term relationship if they wanted to. Well, if things went well.
Right. That's the other side of it is there's a decision there where they could decide to recoup their assets as well on the backside.
Yeah.
If, you know, I mean, maybe he scores 0 points and there's no value there at all. But yeah. That's the risk with every trade you make. So.
Yeah. And really the only other guys from Calgary that we have any interest in talking about today are the guys in net.
Yeah. On this factors, I think it's the first time we've talked about goalies in this series. Be sure to like and subscribe to the video. But the reality is the backup goaltender position is kind of the elephant in the room for the Avalanche coming into this trade deadline.
Today, as of the recording of these videos, yes, absolutely the elephant in the room, a position that needs to be addressed. Big save, David Rittich in Calgary, a free agent to be. His save percentage consistently hovers right around league average. He's shown himself he's not a true starter. But he's
a super plug and place backup.
He's a good backup goaltender.
Yep.
And as to buoy against, even if Pavel Francouz comes back, rust will be a problem there.
Yep.
And Rittich solves that problem, I think, right off the top. You get a backup. It's not a guy that you're ever worried about taking Grubauer's job.
Right.
And he leaves at the end of the year if you're comfortable with that.
Rittich is. The problem is solved. You don't have to think about it again, you know, barring more injury.
Yeah, well, and if you go out and you get David Rittich and Francouz comes back and then Grubauer gets hurt and then Rittich gets hurt and Francouz gets hurt, you can't say anything.
When it's not your year, it's not your year.
You can't. Like, there isn't anything. There's no team in the NHL that is going to go out and be like, well, what about our fourth goaltender?
Right. No. Does not happen.
Are the Avs in need of a true backup option to be on the safe side of things? Absolutely. If Philip Grubauer goes down, are the Avs still cup favorites with David Rittich in net? No. Absolutely not.
No.
It becomes a much harder road no matter what if Grubauer goes down. I mean, there is no true guardrail against that injury that is realistically available.
If the starter goes down right now, is there more than one team in the league that is a cup favorite? Because Vegas is the only one I can think
of. I mean, I think Vegas, I guess Dallas would have been it, but they haven't had Ben Bishop all year.
Yeah, he's been out.
And look where they are.
They're not great.
Fighting for a playoff spot because their backup is now their starter.
Yep.
I would say Carolina might be the only other one.
Well, they're looking to move some goalies too, which we'll talk about later. But
Reimer, Mrazek, and Nedeljkovic, they are
deep enough, maybe.
They're in decision-making mode right now.
For sure. Sticking to Calgary, though, Rittich is the complete answer, but if there is a universe where Francouz gets back in a reasonable time frame for, let's call it, the playoffs.
Yeah.
They also have Louis Domingue.
Yeah, has not played this year, but has shown well in the NHL in the past.
Yep,
has is a track more record. Is more of your classic third goaltender than a real backup, but for Colorado's purposes, would make a lot of sense. And frankly, should be cheaper than David Rittich. So if they didn't want to pay the big Save Dave tax,
yeah,
whatever Louis Domingue costs is probably something more. That would be a more palatable traditional deadline deal.
I can't imagine. You're probably, at worst, you're in Sakic's wheelhouse of like fourth round picks.
Yeah, loves dealing.
He sure does. Any even numbered pick, just yeeted by Joe Sakic. Well,
and he loves trading. Like the fourth round is his favorite round to trade in and out of.
Yeah, in it. Yeah, that, I don't know. He goes crazy. He really likes trading seconds too.
Oh, he does. Yeah, I think he's traded five of them in his time as GM.
Yeah, well, yeah, he's traded a bunch of them out, and then he's also traded back out of the second as mm-hmm. well. So, yeah, not a lot of picks in the second round for the Avs as they are right now, but. The goaltender position, is Calgary really a realistic target here? I think Rittich, I struggle to see him being really available at the deadline.
That would have to be the Flames are, no doubt about it, done.
Yeah.
And then if they're in that position, I think I value Rittich over Domingue.
Even
with the additional price tag, even if it's, you know, you're digging into a second round pick in 2023.
I mean, let's be honest, the goal for this season for the Colorado Avalanche is to win a Stanley Cup, right?
Yeah.
So don't halfway it with a Louis Domingue if you can get Rittich.
Yeah, and that guy, he's also a guy that you would be comfortable enough using the second half of the season to give a couple of starts to let Philip Grubauer actually get real rest.
Yep.
He is not a plug-and-play, hope-and-pray third goaltender. That is a guy that you have expectations of success with.
You're playing against San Jose, Anaheim. Those are teams you would expect to win against.
You remember that. I think their last five or six games of the season are all LA and San Jose.
Yep.
So that would be an important, hey, we're still chasing the division, but they're going to give Grubauer some rest. Rittich is a guy that you could play in multiple games in a row. To accomplish both goals.
You can go into those games and say, this is winnable with three goals, possibly, yep. Not five.
Oh, jeez. What a world.
What a world. Plenty more goalie talk to come in future videos. Hopefully you'll keep tuning in. Be sure, again, to subscribe to the channel and check out thednvr.com. Consider signing up for a membership to help support us and all of our amazing content. I'm Rudo for AJ. We will talk to you guys again in our next video.